Thank you very much. So first of all, I would like to express my deep gratitude to Professor Jin. So as he said yesterday, so in last workshop notes and special graph 2011, I was one of the speakers, but I could not attend the workshop because of Tohoku earthquake. So I would like to thank Professor Jin for giving me a chance to talk at this workshop. Thank you very much. So anyway, today I will give a talk about invariance of knots and links in a spatial graph. The content of this talk is partially joint work with Hiroka Hashimoto, who was my graduate student, and Professor Taniyama. First of all, I prepare some basic notations which are used in this talk.
Okay.
Let G be a finite graph. Let G be a finite graph. A subgraph gamma of G is called a K-cycle of a G if gamma is homeomorphic to a circle and contains exactly K edges. Okay. We denote the set of all K cycles of G by capital gamma KG. And also, we denote the set of all cycles of G by capital gamma G. Okay. Moreover, capital gamma NG is just capital gamma G if N is equal to 1. And the set of all unions of mutually disjoint N cycles of G if N is greater than or equal to 2. Okay. And capital gamma bar G is a set of all unions of all capital gamma NG. Okay? That is, capital gamma bar G is a set of all of the closed one manifolds in the graph G. Okay. We use these symbols in this talk. And let G be a graph. Then an embedding of a graph G into the three space if it's called a spatial embedding of a graph G. And the image of F is called spatial graph, as illustrated in here. Okay. So let gamma, for example, let gamma 1 and gamma 2 be two cycles of G, as described by red color, like this. Okay. Then we can see that gamma 1 is two cycles, and gamma 2 be three cycles. So gamma 1 contains exactly two edges, and gamma 2 contains exactly three edges. So gamma 1 is belong to capital gamma 2 G, and gamma 2 is belong to capital gamma 3 G. And the union of gamma 1 and gamma 2 is belong to the capital gamma 2 G. Okay. Then the image of gamma I by F is not a knot in a spatial graph FG, like this. Okay, so this is trefoil knot and this is a trivial knot. And moreover, the image of gamma 1 union gamma 2 by F is a two-component link in a spatial graph FG, like this. Okay, and so we denote the set of all of the spatial embeddings of graph G by SEG, so spatial embedding of G. Okay, so we use this symbol. Okay, so basic preparation is finished. So let me go the section one. So we recall the Conway-Gordon theorem, which is the most famous, so in my opinion, which is the most famous theorem in spatial graph theory. Okay, section one. So let Kn be the complete graph on n vertices. That is, Kn is a one skeleton of n minus one simplex if n is greater than or equal to 2. For example, this picture shows the complete graph on five vertices. Okay. Then, the following theorem 1.1 is called the Conway-Gordon theorem. So, one, for any spatial embedding f of the complete graph on six vertices, it follows that the sum of the linking numbers over all of the constituent two component links is congruent to 1 modulo 2. Okay? And 2, for any special embedding F of the complete graph on 7 vertices, it follows that the sum of A2 F gamma over all of the constituent Hamiltonian knot is congruent to 1 modulo 2. Where a cycle is called is said to be Hamiltonian if it contains the all of it contains all of the vertices, and AI denotes the ith coefficient of the Conway polynomial for oriented link. Okay, this theorem is called Conway-Gordon's theorem. Then Conway-Gordon's theorem also implies the following fact. Okay, definition 1.2. So let G be a graph, then G is said to be intrinsically linked if for any special embedding F of G, the image of F always contains a non-splittable two-component link. Okay. And G is said to be intrinsically knotted if for any special embedding F of G, the image of F always contains a non-trivial knot. Okay. Then let us recall the Conway-Gordon theorem. So by Conway-Gordon K6 theorem, it follows that every special complete graph on 6 vertices contains a two-component link with odd linking number, namely non-splittable. Moreover, every special so by the Conway-Gordon K7 theorem, it follows that every special complete graph on 7 vertices contains a knot with half-invariant 1, namely non-trivial. Therefore, we have the following corollary 1.3. So K6 is intrinsically linked and K7 is intrinsically knotted. For example, let us consider this special complete graph on 6 vertices. Then, in fact, this complete graph on 6 vertices contains a unique non-splittable link as a hop link, like this. And this embedding is famous, so by Conway-Gordon. So this is an example of spatial complete graph on 7 vertices. Then we can check that this spatial graph contains exactly one non-trivial knot by describing this color. And this knot is a trefoil knot. So half invariant is 1. Okay. Okay. So then we can obtain another intrinsically linked and intrinsically knotted graph from K6 and K7 in the following way. So definition 1.4. So a triangle Y exchange. A triangle Y exchange is an operation on just the abstract graph to obtain a new graph GY from a graph G triangle by removing three edges UV, VW, and W of a three-cycle triangle and adding a new vertex X and connecting it to each of the vertices U, V, and W as illustrated here. This is triangle Y exchange. So from left to right is triangle Y exchange. And a Y triangle exchange is the reverse of this operation. So from right to left. Okay, this is a triangle Y exchange and Y triangle exchange. Then the following proposition, 1.5, holds. So one, if a graph G triangle, this graph, G triangle, if G triangle is intrinsically linked, then GY is also intrinsically linked. Okay. And two, if a graph G triangle is intrinsically knotted, then GY is also intrinsically knotted. So triangle Y exchange preserves the intrinsically linkedness and intrinsically knottedness. So this proposition is very famous, and as the warming up of this talk, I want to give the proof of this proposition. Okay. Okay, so we prepare some definitions. So we denote the set of all elements in capital gamma bar G triangle containing triangle by this symbol. Okay, I'm sorry. So the symbol is complicated. And let gamma prime be an element of capital gamma G triangle not containing a triangle. Then there exists an element phi bar gamma prime in the capital gamma G Y such that a gamma prime set minus triangle is equal to the phi bar gamma prime set minus Y as illustrated in here. Okay. And if gamma prime does not intersect with the edges of triangle, then phi bar gamma prime is equal to gamma prime, just gamma prime. Then the correspondence from gamma prime to phi bar gamma prime defines a natural surjective map from the set of all elements in capital gamma G triangle not containing a triangle to the capital gamma G Y. Okay? Natural surjective map. Then we remark here that for any element gamma in capital gamma G Y, okay, then the inverse image of gamma by phi bar contains at most two elements. Okay? This picture illustrates this fact if the inverse image of gamma by phi bar contains exactly two elements, gamma 1 prime and gamma 2 prime. Okay? Moreover, in general, the following proposition 1.6 holds. So let gamma be an element of gamma bar GY. Then the inverse image of gamma by phi bar contains exactly one element, if and only if gamma contains all of the u, v, w, and x, or gamma does not contain x. Okay. This is natural surjective. Yes?
UVW and X.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. On the other hand, we consider a special embedding. So let F be a special embedding of GY. Then by attaching a two-dimensional disk along FY, like this, and by taking the boundary of the disk, we can obtain a special embedding phi f of G triangle as illustrated in here. Okay. Then the correspondence from f to phi f also defines a map from SEGY to SEG triangle. Okay. Then for two maps, capital phi bar and this phi, we have the following proposition, 1.7. Let F be a special embedding of GY, and gamma be an element in capital gamma GY. Then the image of gamma by F is ambient isotopic to phi F gamma prime for any element gamma prime in the inverse image of gamma by phi bar. Okay. So this picture illustrates this fact if the inverse image of gamma contains exactly two elements, gamma 1 prime and gamma 2 prime. So namely, so F gamma is a knot as described by red color, like this. And then phi F gamma 1 prime and phi F gamma 2 prime are two knots, like this. Then we can see that both phi f gamma 1 prime and phi f gamma 2 prime are ambient isotopic to f gamma. Okay? And moreover, we can see that phi f gamma 1 prime and phi f gamma 2 prime are also ambient isotopic along this two disk. Okay? Okay, so now we can prove the proposition 1.5. So we show only two, namely, if G triangle is intrinsically knotted, then
GY is also intrinsically knotted. Let F be a special embedding of GY. Then there exists a cycle gamma prime of G triangle such that phi F gamma prime is a non-trivial knot because phi F is a special embedding of G triangle. And by the assumption, G triangle is intrinsically knotted. So it follows that phi F gamma prime is a non-trivial knot. Okay. Note that gamma prime is not equal to triangle because phi F triangle is a trivial knot. But phi F gamma prime is a non-trivial knot, so gamma prime is not equal to triangle. Then let us consider a cycle phi bar gamma prime of the GY. Then it follows that the image of phi bar gamma prime by F is ambient isotopic to phi F gamma prime by a previous proposition 1.6. And as we see that phi F gamma prime is a non-trivial knot, so we have that the image of phi bar gamma prime by F is also a non-trivial knot. This implies that the image of every special embedding F of GY contains a non-trivial knot. So we have GY is also intrinsically knotted. Okay? So in such a way, we can carry the intrinsically knottedness and intrinsically intrinsically linkedness and intrinsically knottedness for K6 and K7 to the one for another graph by a triangle by exchange. But our purpose in this talk is to carry not only intrinsically linkedness and intrinsically knottedness, but also Conway-Gordon type dependent relation on the invariants of knots and links for graph to the one for another graph. Okay, so we want to carry the Conway-Gordon type theorem for another graph by triangle by exchange. This is our purpose. So in this next section, we explain the general result for our purpose. Okay, let me go in section two. So the content of this section is mainly partially joint work with Professor Taniyama. Okay. Sorry. Okay, let capital A be an additive group and alpha be an A-valued unoriented link invariant. Okay, unoriented link invariant. So we introduce the next definition. So definition 2.1. So this invariant alpha is said to be compressible if for a link which contains a trivial knot as a split component, then alpha L is equal to zero. Okay, for such link, alpha L is equal to zero. In particular, if L is a trivial knot, then alpha L is also equal to zero. Okay, when this condition is satisfied, the alpha is said to be compressible. Then, suppose that for any element gamma prime in the gamma bar G triangle, an A-valued unoriented link invariant alpha gamma prime is assigned. So roughly speaking, so each element gamma prime in capital gamma bar G triangle so has a uniform number attached by an A-valued unoriented link invariant. Okay, uniform number by an invariant. Then let gamma be an element of capital gamma bar G Y. So then we give the uniform number for this gamma. Namely, we define an A-valued unoriented link invariant alpha tilde gamma in the following way. So for link L, alpha tilde gamma L is equal to the sum of alpha gamma prime L over all elements gamma prime in the inverse image of gamma by phi bar. Okay. Then alpha tilde gamma is also an A-valued unoriented link invariant, which is attached to gamma. Okay. Then the following lemma holds. So lemma 2.2. So if alpha gamma prime is compressible for any element gamma prime in the capital gamma G triangle, containing triangle, then it follows that for any special embedding F of GY, the sum of alpha tilde gamma F gamma over all elements in capital gamma GY is equal to the sum of alpha gamma prime phi F gamma prime over all elements gamma prime in capital gamma G triangle. Okay. Okay, we give the proof of this lemma. So the first equality holds by the assumption that alpha gamma prime is compressible. Okay. So it is clear. And note that the set of all elements in capital gamma budget triangle not containing a triangle is equal to the union of the inverse image of gamma by phi bar over all elements in capital gamma GY, because capital phi bar is a surjective map. Okay? Then by this fact, the second equality holds. Okay? Moreover, by proposition 1.7, it follows that F gamma is ambient isotopic to phi F gamma prime for any element gamma prime in the inverse image of gamma by phi bar. So the third equality holds. And finally, by the definition of alpha tilde gamma, it follows that so the fourth equality holds. So this completes the proof of lemma 2.2. Okay. Then, by using lemma 2.2, we have the following theorem immediately. So theorem 2.3. So suppose alpha gamma prime is compressible for any element gamma prime in the capital gamma G triangle, containing triangle, then if there exists a subset A0 of an additive group A such that for any special embedding G of G triangle, the sum of alpha gamma prime G gamma prime over all elements gamma prime in the gamma bar G triangle it belongs to A0, then it follows that for any special embedding F of graph GY, the sum of alpha tilde gamma F gamma over all elements in gamma prime gamma bar GY is also belong to A0. Okay? So the proof is clear by lemma 2.2. So actually, let F be a special embedding of GY. Then this equality is just lemma 2.2, and the right side is belong to A0 by the assumption. So we have the left side is also belong to A0. So this completes the proof. But so I'm afraid. So this theorem 2.3 is a fairly generalized form for our purpose, and I'm afraid it may be hard to understand for you. So I give an example. Okay, let Q7 be the graph obtained from K6 by a single triangle Y exchange, as illustrated in here. Okay, Q7 is just this graph. So let gamma prime be an element of capital gamma K6. Then let me give the uniform number of gamma prime by a Z2 valued unoriented link invariant. Namely, we define that alpha gamma prime for a link L, alpha gamma prime L is equal to the modulo 2 reduction of the first coefficient of the Conway polynomial for link L. Okay. Then if L is not a two-component link, so you know that the first coefficient vanishes. So alpha gamma prime is trivial invariant. And if L is a two-component link, then it is very famous that the first coefficient coincide with the linking number. So alpha gamma prime is the modulo 2 linking number. Anyway, we can see that alpha gamma prime is compressible Z2 invariant. Okay. Then, by Conway-Gordon K6 theorem, it follows that for any special embedding G of K6, the sum of alpha gamma prime G gamma prime over all elements in capital gamma K6 is equal to 1 in Z2. Okay. Then, by theorem 2.3, it also follows that for any special embedding F of Q7, we have the sum of alpha tilde gamma F gamma over all elements in capital gamma Q7 is also equal to 1 in Z2. Namely, in theorem 2.3, so we take a zero as the one element set 1. Okay, a zero is one element set. Then note that the restricted map of phi bar on the set of all elements in capital gamma 2 K6 not containing triangle is bijective, because any element gamma in the capital gamma 2 Q7 contains all vertices of Q7. And by proportion 1.6, in this case, the inverse image of gamma by phi bar contains exactly one element. So the restricted map phi bar on this set is bijective. Okay. Therefore, we have for element gamma in the capital gamma 2 Q7, it follows that the alpha tilde gamma coincides with the first coefficient of the Conway polynomial, and so the linking number well. So we have that. So 1 is equal to the sum of alpha tilde gamma, and by this fact, this sum of alpha tilde gamma is equal to the sum of linking numbers, modulo 2 linking numbers, over all of the constituent 2 component links in Z2. Okay. Namely, this is Conway-Gordon type theorem for Q7. Okay, so that is, we carry the Conway-Gordon theorem for K6 to the Conway-Gordon type theorem for Q7 by a triangle by exchange by using theorem 2.3. Okay, this is our method to carry the Conway-Gordon type theorem. Okay. By the way, Conway-Gordon theorem is just the dependent relation on invariants over Z2. So it is a little weak. So in the next section, let us consider the Conway-Gordon type dependent relation on invariants, not Z2, but also over integers. Okay. So that section 3 is Conway-Gordon type theorems over integers. Okay. So we prepare some notation. So definition 3.1. Let G be a graph. Then we denote the set of all graphs obtained from G by a finite sequence of triangle Y and Y triangle exchanges by script FG, and called it the G family. Okay. We also denote the set of all graphs obtained from G by a finite sequence of only triangle Y exchanges by script F triangle Z. Okay. For example, K6 family consists of seven graphs as illustrated in here. And the end graph P10 is isomorphic to the Petersen graph, which is very famous in graph theory. So K6 family is also called the Petersen family. So Petersen family is very famous in graph theory and spatial graph theory. And note that there exists exactly one graph, P7, which in K6 family, which cannot be obtained from K6 by a finite sequence of only triangle by exchanges. Okay? Namely, the script F triangle K6 consists of these six graphs. Okay. Okay, this is Petersen family. And moreover, K7 family consists of 20 graphs as illustrated in here. And the end graph C14 is isomorphic to the Hilt graph, which is very famous in graph theory. So K7 family is also called the Hilt family. And note that there exists exactly six graphs which cannot be obtained from K7 by a finite sequence of only triangular exchanges. Okay. Namely, the script F triangle K7 consists of 14 graphs as illustrated in here. So these 14 graphs will appear in the second talk in this afternoon session. Okay. Okay. And by the proportion 1.5, so any graph which belongs to F triangle, script F triangle K7 is intrinsically knotted. Yeah? Okay. Then, for K6 and K7, the following integral lists of Conway-Gordon theorems known. So theorem 3.2. So the one, for any special embedding F of the complete graph on six vertices, then it follows that so this weighted sum of A2 over constituent knots with respect to F is equal to the sum of squares of linking number over all of the constituent two-component links minus one. Okay. This equality holds. And two, for any special embedding F of the complete graph on seven vertices, it follows that the weighted sum, so it is a little complicated, but so this weighted sum of A2 over constituent knot is equal to the twice of the square of the linking number over all of the constituent two-component links, corresponding to the pair of three cycle and four cycle, minus 21. Okay. Then we remark here that the Conway-Gordon original theorem can be obtained from this theorem 3.2. That is, by taking the modulus reduction on this theorem, so then the sum of the linking number over all of the constituent two-component links is congruent to 1, modulo 2. This is Conway-Gordon K6 theorem. And by taking the modulus reduction of the second equation, so we had the sum of A2 over all of the constituent Hamiltonian knot is equal is congruent to 1, modulo 2. Namely, Conway-Gordon K7 theorem. So that is why this theorem 3.2 are integral lifts of original Conway-Gordon theorem. Okay? Then, by considering these invariants as integer-valued invariant, by combining theorem 2.3 and this theorem 3.2, we have the following theorem 3.3. Okay? First, for any graph which can be obtained from K6 by a finite sequence of only triangular exchange, there exists a map omega from capital Z to integers, such that the twice such that for any special embedding or F of G, the twice of the weighted sum of A2 with respect to omega over all elements in capital gamma Z is equal to the sum of the squares of the linking number over all of the constituent two-component links, minus one. Okay. And two, so for any graph G which can be obtained from K7 by a finite sequence of only triangular exchange, there exists a map omega from capital gamma bar G to the integers, such that for any special embedding F of G, it follows that the weighted sum of A2 with respect to omega over all elements in capital gamma Z is equal to the twice of the weighted sum of the square of the linking numbers over all of the constituent two-component links minus 21. Okay. And we remark here that there exists exactly one graph P7 which cannot be obtained from K6 by only triangular I exchanges. And a similar formula for P7 was given by Oddnor. Okay. So I forget to remark. So P7 is isomorphic to the complete graph on a complete tripartite graph K331. Okay. Anyway, in the case of K7 family, so we will comment later. So anyway, by taking the modulus reduction on this theorem 3.3, we have the following corollary. So the one for any graph in the K6 family, for any special embedding F of G, the sum of squares, sum of linking numbers F comma over all of the constituent two-component links is congruent to 1, modulo 2. Namely, Comey-Gordon type theorem, as similar as K6, holds for any graph in the K6 family. So note that this has already pointed out by Sachs and Taniyama and Yasuhara. But their method is to check each graph in K6 family directly by using the original Conway-Gordon's argument. But in our method, essentially, so the K6 case, it is sufficient to check the K6 case and by application of our theorem. And two, for any graph G which can be obtained from K7 by a finite sequence of only triangular by exchange, there exists a subset capital gamma of capital gamma G such that for any special embedding F of G, the sum of A2F gamma over all of the constituent knots corresponding to all elements in capital gamma is congruent to 1 modulo 2. Okay. So we can find such a subset gamma which depends only on graph G, so does not depend on special embedding. Okay. Okay, so we remark here that all of 6 graphs in K7 family which cannot be obtained from K7 by a finite sequence of only triangular by exchanges are not intrinsically knotted. Okay. So this was shown by Frappmann and Naimi in the case of N'10. And the other case was shown by Hanaki, me, Professor Taniyama, and Yamazaki, who was my graduate student. And I forget to write, so this was shown independently by Goldberg, Mattman, and Naimi. We should remark here that the existence of the map omega, the proof of the existence of map omega is constructive. So it is not so simple, but we can theoretically give a map omega concretely. Actually, so the K6 case was given by me, and the K331 case was given by Oddnor. And the other case, such a map omega was given by Hashimoto and me. In the previous not school, so Hiroka Hashimoto gave a talk about these topics. Okay, and of course, in the K7 case, the proof of the existence of map omega is also constructive, it is not so simple. But let us consider the Hilt graph C14. Okay, so end graph Hilt graph. Then, though we omit the details, but we can show that for any special embedding F of the Hilt graph, it follows that the sum of A2, F gamma, over all of the constituent knots corresponding to the 12 cycle and the 14 cycle. And note that 14 cycle is Hamiltonian cycle. So this sum is congruent to what? Module 2. Okay? Namely, we can take capital gamma as the we can take the set of 12 cycle and 14 cycles as capital gamma. Okay, so let F and G be two special embeddings of the Hilbert graph as illustrated in here. Okay. Then, in fact, the image of F contains exactly one non-trivial knot as a Hamiltonian knot as described by the red color, like this. Okay. So this is a unique non-trivial knot in this embedding. So this fact has already exhibited by Kohara and Suzuki in 1992. But so in fact, the image of G also contains exactly one non-trivial knot, but non-trivial knot as described by red color, like this. Okay. But this trivial knot is non-Hamiltonian. So this non-trivial knot is a 12 cycle. And this is a unique non-trivial knot in this embedding. So as far as I know, this embedding is a new example of such a special embedding of the Hilbert graph. Okay. Anyway, by high symmetry of the Hilbert graph, these examples show that the set of all 12 cycles and 14 cycles of Hilbert graph is minimal for intrinsically knottedness in some sense. Okay, and in the rest of this talk, we can consider another intrinsically knotted graph, which is not belong to K7 family. Okay, section 4. So Conway-Gordon type 7 for K3311. Let K3311 be the complete four-partite graph, as illustrated in here, where X and Y denote the exactly two vertices with valency 7. Okay. So it is known that this K3311 is not belong to K7 family. But Hoshi showed the following theorem 4.1 in 2002. So K3311 is intrinsically knotted. And moreover, K3311 is minor minimal intrinsically knotted graph, which is not belong to K7 family. Okay? But we should remark, so this fact was pointed out by Kohara and Suzuki, so there exists a special embedding F of K3311, such that the sum of A2, F gamma, over all of the constituent Hamiltonian knot. So Hamiltonian cycle of K3311 is an 8th cycle. So the sum of A2, F gamma, over all of the constituent Hamiltonian knot is congruent to 0, module 2. So such an embedding exists. So please recall that Conway and Gordon prove the intrinsically knottedness for K7 by giving the sum of A2 over all of the constituent Hamiltonian knot is congruent to 1 module 2. But since such an embedding exists, so Conway-Gordon's original argument does not work in the case of K3311. Actually, Hoshi used the another idea. So we omit the details, but by another idea, Hoshi showed that for any special embedding F of K3311, there exists a 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8 cycle gamma, such that HF gamma is congruent to 1, module 2. Namely, we cannot identify the place of non-trivial knot in special K3311 by Hoshi's result. So our purpose in this section is defining the Hoshi's result by giving the kind of Conway-Gordon type theorem for K3311 in the following way. Okay. So theorem 4.2. So let F be a special embedding of K3311. Then the following two relations hold. So the one, for any special embedding F of K3311, so it is complicated, but this weighted sum of A2 over all of the consistent knots. So where X and Y are two vertices with valency 7. So anyway, so this weighted sum is equal to the weighted sum of the square of the linking numbers over all of the consistent two-component links, corresponding to a pair of three-cycle and five-cycle and two mutually disjoint four-cycle, minus 18. Okay. And the following is also hold. So this weighted sum of the square of the linking numbers over all of the constituent two-component links is greater than or equal to 22. Okay. Then, so by combining 1 and 2, so this part is greater than or equal to 22. So in the first equality, so the right side is more than or equal to 4. Then dividing both sides by 4, we have the following corollary. Okay, corollary 4.3. So let F be a special embedding of K3311. Then the previous weighted sum of A2, like this, is greater than or equal to 1. Namely, there exists a cycle gamma which is belong to the one of the set of cycles appears in the left side, such that A2F gamma is not equal to 0. So in particular, we can prove that K3311 is intrinsically knotted. So this is an alternative proof for the intrinsically knottedness of K3311. Okay. And corollary 4.3 refines Foyce's result at a point of identifying the place of non-trivial knot in the image of F. Okay. But unfortunately, we cannot prove that every special every special K3311 contains a non-trivial Hamiltonian knot. But at least corollary 4.3 refines the Foyce's result. Okay. And so, okay, so we note that let us consider the modulo 2 reduction of the left side on corollary 4.3. Okay. Then let us consider two special embeddings of K3311 as illustrated in here. Then we omit the details, but we can check that left side of corollary 4.3 is equal to 1 for the right left embedding and is equal to 2 for right embedding. Namely, by taking the modulo 2 reduction, we have the left side of corollary 4.3 is congruent to 1 modulo 2 in the left embedding and congruent to 0 modulo 2 by for right embedding. So in this case, the argument over Z2 does not work, but the argument over integers works. So this example shows that the argument over integers have a nice advantage. So namely, this corollary 4.3 is our Conway-Gordon type theorem for K3311, which is not equality, but this is inequality. So this is a Conway-Gordon type theorem for inequality type. Okay. Okay, and moreover, we consider the graphs in K3311 family. Okay. Note that the K3311 family consists of 58 graphs, and there exist exactly 26 graphs which can be obtained from K3311 by a finite sequence of only triangle by exchanges. There are 26 graphs. Then, by theorem 2.3 and corollary 4.3, we have the following theorem. So, Let G be a graph for any graph G which can be obtained from K3311 by a finite sequence of only triangle by exchange. Then there exists a map omega from capital gamma G to integers such that for any special embedding F of K3311, the weighted sum of A2 with respect to omega over all of the constituent not is greater than or equal to 1. So we recall theorem 2.3. So sorry. Okay. So we take a zero by the set of positive integers in this case. Sorry. Okay. So we take a zero by the positive integers, the set of positive integers. Okay. So this theorem 4.4 holds. Okay. So we should remark that it has been announced that all of the 32 graphs which cannot be obtained from K3311 by a finite sequence of only triangle by exchanges are also intrinsically knotted. So this has been announced by Goldberg, Mattman, and Naimi. So as far as I know, so this paper has been a preprint yet, but you can see this paper in archive. So I don't know whether a kind of Conway-Goldman-type theorem holds for these 32 graphs. So I don't know, but it is an interesting problem, I think. Okay. Okay, so finally, we mention the further two studies. So the first study is characterization of knot types and link types in a special graph. In particular, application to molecular topology. So that is, so a special graph is said to be rectilinear or simply a linear if each of the special edges is a straight line segment in the three space. So in molecular topology, a rectilinear special graph appears as a mathematical model for chemical compound. So the study of rectilinear special graph is important, I think. And by our Conway-Gordon type theorem over integers, in fact, we can prove that every rectilinear special complete graph on seven vertices contains a trefoil knot. So we can characterize the knot type of a non-trivial knot in the rectilinear special complete graph on seven vertices. Okay. So this fact has already proven by Alfonsin by using the matroid theory and the computers. But so we can give the alternative proof of this fact by the Conway-Gordon type theorem over integers. And moreover, in fact, we can prove that every rectilinear special K3311 always contains a non-trivial Hamiltonian knot. So recall that by our Conway-Gordon type theorem for K3311, so we can not prove that every special K3311 contains a non-trivial Hamiltonian knot. This is an open problem. But in the case of rectilinear special graph, we can prove that every rectilinear special K3311 contains a non-trivial Hamiltonian knot. Okay. So our Conway-Gordon type theorem for over integers has a nice advantage. Okay. And the second study is dependent relation on other invariants of knots and links in a special graph. So that is, our Conway-Gordon type theorem, which appears in this talk, is only dependent relation on the finite type invariants of order less than or equal to 2. So I think to find the dependent relation on finite type invariants of order more than or equal to 3 is important because I believe such a dependent relation of invariants is also useful for the first study, so characterization of knot types and link types in the special graph. Chunbe will give a talk about linear special complete graph on 8 vertices in this afternoon. Okay, I would like to stop here. Thank you very much again.